In our study of Hosea, we have just got through the first 11 verses, and we're going to be continuing just working with those verses 8 through 11. And the study is really about trying to unfold for us an understanding, a place in the Word of God that we can go to where we can examine and look at and respond to the depth of God's love. And we are trying to get a better grasp of that. You can go into the Word of God and you can go to all sorts of places where it talks about the loving kindness and compassion of God. And those are the words that are used over and over and over and over and over again. And everywhere you go in the Psalms, they're in almost every single Psalm. But to study what that means, to see it in a deeper manner than just saying the loving kindness of God and the compassion of God, to allow yourself to find a place in the Word of God that looks at it deeper, has more to say in relationship to what it is and what it does and how God's heart is really feeling, it's not that easy to find those passages. And these passages that we're studying, there are a place in the Word of God from 11 through 14 that does that. And so that's why we've turned to them in this study, to give us a chance to engage in looking at and comprehending, as Ephesians 3, 14 through 17 says. Okay, and I've asked you to pray that prayer, that you would ask God to grant you, okay, the strengthening in your own self to where you can comprehend this and to where it can become more real to you, and that it's almost like tasting it. Okay, it is a knowledge, but it's also a knowing within inside the soul. And the truth of the matter, I believe when you look at man, as man walks upon the face of the earth, there are two basic issues that God is trying for us to understand. And one of the issues is that he loves us and that you can trust this love, that you can have faith in this love, okay? That what he says to you is true and that what he says to you is right. And the message that we received from Ron this morning, that's not an easy message. And it's not a message that's hardly anybody in this room is living real well at. Okay, and yet it's a message of love, and it's a message of truth. And for we as humans, when God says, don't do this because it'll hurt you, or do this because it'll make you grow, we immediately respond as though that's not true. It's very simple for us to respond that way inside of our heart. And what we find is, if you go down to the core of that, is we're not sure if we can trust the love that God has said. We've looked at all the circumstances of life, and the life itself has been very, very, very difficult at times. And you sometimes wonder how that is love. And I can say within myself, from my battle when I was 17 years old to 28, when I wandered off from God, the issue was I didn't believe he loved me. Okay, I thought that what he said, okay, was not the truth, because it didn't work out in life, and it brought pain. It didn't bring power; it brought pain. And those kinds of things are question marks in the minds of men. And what God is trying to do is to place those question marks, those circumstances that are part of your life, and he is telling you, you've got to deny these circumstances as being the truth. They're not the truth. Okay? My love is the truth. And this circumstance that you're going through that screams at you that I don't love you is absolutely wrong. Okay? And I will take that circumstance over a period of time and demonstrate my love to you. But the problem is we have a very hard time finding that. Okay? I believe that is one of the very basic issues that mankind is dealing with, because that's what Adam and Eve dealt with. I mean, we're just like them. we really do not trust, have faith in, or love, trust his love. And we have a very hard time dealing with that. Okay. And I feel as my life has progressed, one of the basic prayers is this prayer that comes out of Ephesians. Okay. Grant that my faith does not fail, that my faith becomes stronger and stronger and stronger, and that I truly taste, truly understand, really involve myself with the height and the depth and the width of the love of God, so I might be filled up with him. Okay. And I believe that is the basic issue that we are having to deal with here on this earth. Almost every day we deal with it. Okay. I get up right now because I'm tired and I'm worn out, and many of you are doing the same thing in terms of this stage of life and dealing with sicknesses and dealing with things that are difficult and whatever, and you get up and you just wonder inside. You know, it's not where God is, but it is a sense inside of a kind of a lostness, you know, a sense of, you know, and the truth of it is when you walk into that pattern, okay, that emotion, at least in my mind, I don't know about you, but in my mind, there is this question mark that goes, where is God? Okay. Now, I've learned not to say that. Okay. I've come to trust that what he says is that he is there, and that there is meaning in this loneliness. There is meaning in this pain. Okay. But you've got to find that in the Word. You can't just have a word go loving kindness. You know? You've got to see that in depth. Okay? For it to hold your soul while you walk through the pains of life. Okay? And so that's essentially what you have to see when we study this Word. Because this is new. It's new to me. I never studied this passage. Okay? And so I hope that it becomes some window, an insight into more the nature and the meaning of God's love for us. Okay, when God tells you in this passage in verse 8, how can I give you up? That my soul and my heart is turned over inside of me because you have not listened to me. But I cannot give you up. I cannot give you up. And I will not destroy you, though you deserve to be destroyed. But I will not do that, because I am God. And I love you. My compassions drive me to not give you up. Even though when I call to you, and I call to you, and I call to you, you neglect me. And you do not exalt me. Now those are the words that are being said in this passage. Okay? Those are the words that are being said. And what it helps us see is that in the midst of our wanderings and in the midst of our apathy, in the midst of our rebellion, in the midst of our choosing our own counsel, which is one of the sins right before all of this, how can I give you up? How can I do this? How we choose our own counsel. Okay. In the midst of this, God is saying these things. And it's an enormous comfort. It is enormous insight that God himself is driven by this love, this compassion. And he will not give you up. Now, to reemphasize this, this passage is all of this, clear through 14, it starts with the love of God, and then it goes to your sin, our sins as human beings. Then it goes back to the love of God. Then it goes to our sins. Then it goes back to the love of God. Then it goes to our sins, and it goes back to the love of God. That is the pattern from 11 to 14. He breaks out in this enormous anguish of love.
Okay, how can I do that? There is no way that I could ever do that. That's the how, four times. There isn't anything that I can see that I would ever let you go. Okay? There, that's what he's saying. And I am driven, that's what it says, I am driven by my compassion. Okay? I'm driven, verse 8, all of my compassions are kindled, and I will not execute my fierce anger. I am turned in my heart over by the kindling of these compassions towards you. Now, you can read these words, but you have got to find these words to settle your love for him and that he loves you and to have faith in it. Okay? And that's the process here. I mean, this is what's going on. Yes.
Mm-hmm. When Edward was suffering and near death, I asked him if he was mad at God, and he said, no.
Good.
So anymore said,
very good.
Because he was disappointed, you know, that it happened to him.
Mm-hmm.
And I just wanted to know what was going on
inside of him. Yeah. Yeah.
And I was so glad to hear that.
Yeah. And that's where we have to get to. That's right. That's really true. And that's really the demonstration of the flip from Adam and Eve to what he really truly wants. Okay? Really truly wants. Okay? And so that is the process that's growing. And as I've seen myself go through the last 2 years, which have been very hard 2 years, okay, and I feel numb by it. You know, your feelings are almost, you've been hit from so many sides that it's just kind of like they're all battered and you're just numb, you know. But at the same time, you're going, you know, if I'm numb, you know, am I really responding? But what I have felt deep inside at a level that I've not felt a lot in my life is stability and my love for him and the stability of his love for me and my trust that it's there. Okay. Because a lot of my life, I've talked and known and understood, but I've not been able to live. Okay. And so that's what he's taking you to that. You're understanding. It's there. You've talked about it. You really believe it. But when life comes along, you don't find it. It's like a shadow that you're trying to grab and bring into yourself. Okay, it's like a shadow. Okay, you know it's there, but it's not there. And there's this sense of anguish that it was deeper. Okay, and so this is what you find in this passage. It gives you a help. I was with you when you were a child, and you were my son, and I called you out of Egypt. I called you out of your brokenness. I saved you. And then I stood by you and I helped you walk. And when you fell, I picked you up and I held you as you cried. But I let you fall because there's a purpose in the fall. That's exactly what the first four verses talk about in this chapter. Okay? And then it goes on to explain these words that we broke down, where we have I, you know, I did this, I did this, I gave you hope, I delivered you, I gave you my soul, I gave you all this, okay? And then you turned away and left. Okay? Then he goes through the sins, and you decided to go on your own counsel. Okay? And you decided that. It says in verse 7, you're bent on leaving me. You're bent on leaving me. Okay. And then it goes on to say, and I called you, and yet nobody listened. Now, when God says, I have every right to destroy you, okay, when he comes to this next passage and he says, I have every right to destroy you, okay, he's right. He's pursued us and pursued us, and it's taken him so long to get us to a spot to where we really trust his love and are truly given to him. Okay? So that's what you're seeing in this passage. Okay, I will not execute my fierce anger. I will not destroy Ephraim again. Why? Five reasons. Okay, we've already had the four hows. Now we have five other reasons as to why he will not do this. Okay, I will not destroy, for I am God. Now the five are on the second sheet. They're on the second sheet. And it begins with the word for in verse 9. Okay, I will not destroy you. The four hows were in front of it. My compassion is turned to you. It is deeply kindled. I cannot give you up. Okay, there is no way to do that. I should drop my anger upon you. Okay, it has actually been aroused as a holy God because you have sinned again. Okay. And I should, but I can't. Why? Because I am kindled in my compassions. Okay. And then he goes on to explain five other reasons. Okay, because in that verse he says, for I will not drop my anger, my fierceness upon you. Okay. And there are four things that he says. I am God. I am not man. I am a holy one. I am in your midst. And they will walk after the Lord. Now those five are all unique. They're all different, and you should study them. And that's what we're going to try to take a little bit of time to look at. Okay, but those are other concepts that are attached to the compassion that has been kindled. And that has caused the heart of God to have been turned over. Okay. And then he comes down at the very end. I will not destroy you. Okay. Four. Okay. And then he gives these five reasons as well. Okay. So that's what we're kind of looking at. All right. Any comment? Okay. Dave, you're itching your ear. Not sure if that's a comment or not. Yeah, that's a comment. Okay. All right. Okay, right. Okay. The first thing that you find after the word for in verse 9 is, I am God. Then it's linked to the next one, and not man. Okay? Now, when we study the Word of God and we go through all the Word of God and we've seen all sorts of things in the Word of God, this one is fairly clear to us. And the more that we study, the more we see it and understand, okay, as to what's going on. The more you look at life and the more you study deep into the physics of life and all the different kinds of things that are there, and the more you read, for instance, Ron was talking to us about heaven, and he gave you that quote. That quote is a really cool quote, okay, in relationship to heaven itself. It is a definition of the very being of God. In lots of ways. In other words, when you begin to understand all that's there, all of a sudden you understand God more. Okay? And when you begin to realize that your senses, particularly at our age, are disappearing, okay, they're not heightening, okay, they're not going the right direction, okay, they're disappearing. Okay? But what you find as a promise is that, and all of us know it, you know, I ask my students, tell me why it is that you know something about God. In Edwin's Ecclesiastical History, the oldest book that we have in the English language. Okay, there is a conversion of Edwin from Anglo-Saxon to Christianity, and one of his things gives what is called the sparrow metaphor, and they're all trying to figure out if they should convert or not. Okay, and this thing comes up with this, and he says, our souls are like
living in darkness, out in the cold, in the winter. We come into a castle through a window, and inside that castle we fly around in the warmth and feed in this castle. Then we find ourselves going out another window, back out into the darkness, okay, and into the cold, and to the winter. Our religion, that's what this man says, our religion tells us things that are about the warm room in the castle, but they do not tell us anything about the darkness on either side. Nothing. We do not know. If this religion can explain to us the darkness that's on the other side, then it's superior and we should convert. And they did. Okay. You know nothing, absolutely nothing about heaven unless God showed it to you. It is a revelation. You cannot write one thing down on a piece of paper. If you write anything down on that piece of paper, you didn't know this previously. It was a darkness to you. The gift that God has given to us is a revelation of what our future is. It is a gift. And you didn't know it. And he gave that to us from his soul. And it's a truth. It is his soul. And that's where we're going. And we who have lived long enough, it's kind of like an assumption, you know, like we were born with this. But that's not the truth. Okay? Everything, it's a gift of love to us. The very last verse in this passage is why God sees his desire and love to be fulfilled within us. It says at the last, they will come trembling like doves, and I will settle them in their houses. Then verse 10, they will walk after the Lord. This is all in the future. Okay, it hadn't happened. And what God says is, the reason I will not turn my anger and my wrath upon you is because my heart is kindled towards you, and I have a plan that will be fulfilled, and you're the center of the plan. You're the center of the plan. Okay? And that will be fulfilled. Okay? And what is the fulfillment? They will finally come to me when I roar like a lion, and they will tremble at it. And by the way, the word tremble is not fear, but enormous heightened exultation. It's not fear. We're not afraid of the lion when he roars. It'll be the second coming. It is the second coming. Okay? We're not afraid of the lion. This is not a fear passage. And what God is saying at the very end of this passage is, you will be with me perfect, and I will put you in your houses. Okay? I will place you in your houses. Okay? And you will be perfect. You will really, truly tremble at my roar. Okay. You will truly tremble at who I am. You will finally have what you have totally losing. Your senses will be exploded to the height of their perfection. And you will be settled in a place that is with me. You will walk with me. Okay? And that's the last verse, okay? And it's the last concept. That's why he does not release his destruction, because he has made a way for man to come out, okay? And in his, every bit of it is driven by his love. Okay? For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. Okay?
And so it is driven by this. And it's this vision that the sons are back. The sons and daughters are whole and they're back. Okay? Now you didn't learn that. I mean, you didn't get that when you were born. You got that because God gave it to you. Okay? He revealed it to you. 95% of what we know in the Bible in relationship to heaven and hell is out of the words of Jesus himself. Okay, they're in the Gospels and they're in Revelation. The Revelation is the revelation of Jesus himself. So 95% of what you know and understand came direct from a direct revelation from God himself to you and me. The other 5% is in the Old Testament. And if you study that about Sheol, it's very vague. It's not clear. And if that's all you had, you wouldn't know very much, okay, as to what heaven was. Well, I finish with this passage in John 14, 1, 3, which to me sums up the last concept, okay, that you find in that verse, last verse of chapter 11. Okay. Let your heart not be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. Very few people talk about that, but this should be one of my favorite verses. Because I had a troubled heart, okay, and the whisper, okay, by Jesus to Peter, because this is who he's talking to. He's talking to all of the 12, but he's really talking to Peter, because Peter has just said he would stand for God, but when the circumstance came, his stand was not there. So it's very similar to us. We speak the words, and we truly believe in our heart at the time that we speak the words. But when the circumstance comes that challenges our love for God and our faith in him, we fold. Okay, we go to question marks, and we go to all sorts of things that are inside of us that question the love of God. Is it there? Is that really true? You know, how can this be? Okay. And that's what Jesus is addressing to Peter. Okay. He's addressing that. And he's saying to Peter straight out, don't let your heart be destroyed by this. Okay. Your failure, do not allow it to destroy your heart. Your failure, do not allow it to destroy your heart. Your sin, do not allow it to destroy your heart. Okay. What you have to come to, Peter, and the very essence, is you have to return to a belief in me and my Father. And let me help you get a grasp of that, because there is this whole process is moving to this end. Okay? The whole process is moving to this end. You will be with me. Okay? You will be with me forever. Cleanse, change, and I read to you First John chapter 3, verses 1 through 3, and another passage when we were studying this, the other passage on love. Because he's making us perfect. But we're going through this trial to I believe, in some way, it is setting us all up for a reservoir of knowledge and experience and brokenness, okay, because we have failed still. But we've encountered the real love of God in the midst of our failure. Okay. And the strengthening of God when we finally got on our knees and said, God, help me, please forgive me, please take me back. And he does. Okay? He does. And that's what he's saying to Peter. Peter, you're going to get on your knees and cry and weep and moan because of your failure. Okay. I want you to know I will take you back. I want you to know that. And I don't want your heart to be completely destroyed. Do not let this thing cause you to be destroyed. Believe in my love. Reach for my love. Okay? And it will be there. And we are moving, Peter, through this hell that you go through. Because this is the worst moment in Peter's life. The very worst. And he failed. He didn't succeed. He failed bitterly. Okay? And God catches him on the other side like the child who has fallen in his walk and picks him up in his arms and says, "Let not your heart be troubled." Our future is yet to be together. I'm going to a place to make preparation for you. And if I go to this place to make a preparation for you and build you a place where you and I will be, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, you may be also. That's exactly what he told him. Okay? Now there is another verse that you have to combine, okay, with that, and that's Luke 22, 31 and 32. Okay? And that's the full picture of the end of this verse. Okay, what I'm talking about is in Hosea 11, the very last verse. Okay, you will walk with me.
Okay. Tell us that, Luke, again.
Luke 22, 31 and 32. Let me just summarize that verse again. Okay, verse 10. God says to us, "You will walk after me, and I will roar like a lion, and you will come trembling to me, trembling to me." That's what twice he says it. Okay. Like when you first came to me in your first sin, brought out of captivity, out of Egypt. Okay, and that's the way he describes it. "And I will settle you in your home," declares the Lord. Okay, so it's the same thing. He's telling the same thing, okay, to the people back in Hosea chapter 11. And Luke 22, it's right after Jesus says this, he had to have said both of them together because that's exactly the same event. But John records this one, Luke records this one. Okay, but you put them together and you've got the full message that Jesus gave to Peter after he made this failure. Okay, and what he basically said to him was, "I have prayed for you. I have prayed for you." Now, again, if I was to ask you, have you ever asked Jesus to pray for you? Do you understand that he is the intercessor, the high priest between you and God? And that is an area that is not hardly looked into. Okay, I haven't looked into it very deep either. Okay, and I would say out of most of my prayers, 99% of them, I am not asking Jesus to pray for me. But this is exactly what Jesus says. And everything that you read about the Word of God, about what he is doing now, one of his major functions as the high priest, he is taking the hand of man and the hand of God and putting them together. Like Job asked, is there anybody that can do that? Okay, and that's what he's doing. And it says directly, "I have prayed for thee." This is the worst moment of your life. And we have permitted Satan to attack you. That's exactly what it says. Okay, it says Satan has asked permission to sift you as wheat. And we've given it. So you're going to be sifted with wheat and you're going to make the worst. This is the worst moment of your life. And we have permitted it. That's a very good statement because nothing comes into your life that is the sifting of wheat that is probably the worst moments you've ever had that God didn't permit it. Okay? And we have permitted it. Okay? And I have prayed for you that you will not fail. that your faith will not fail. Now, when you look at that, it looks like Peter's faith failed. But that's not the truth. Not according to the eyes of God. He sinned horrendously. And he broke it. And cracked it bad. But it didn't fail. Because from the ashes, the phoenix arose. Okay? And God brought that about. I have prayed for thee that your faith not fail. When's the last time that you asked God to pray for you, Jesus to pray for you, that your faith not fail, and perhaps the worst time that you've ever had? Okay. Well, think that through and put in the back of your little cap, okay? Because that's what it says, okay? I pray for you that you would not fail. And when you have come through this, there is a purpose in it all. A strong, strong purpose, Peter. This is the worst failure of your life, and you didn't do this well. But let everybody know that I love you. That I picked you up like a son, and I held you, okay, and I love you. I did not let you to be destroyed, okay? I cannot let you go. I will not surrender you. Okay? I will not destroy you. Okay? I am God and not man. Everything that I am, I give to you. I am God and I am not man. Thus I will not destroy you. Okay? And in your future lies a walk with me. Walk with me, and you will hear my voice, and you will trembly come back in exulting joy. Okay? And I will establish you forever with me. Peter, when you come through this, you tell them that I loved you. You tell them that I walk with you. And those who are going through similar things, comfort them with the comfort that I gave to you. That's exactly what he says. Okay? So those are the things that are being put forth for us in that last set by Hosea. It's an enormously beautiful thing. And you have, what you're listening to is the voice of God. Okay? Speaking about his love about us. Okay? It's not somebody else saying, the loving compassion of God will do this and this. It's not David saying this, okay, even though that's true. Okay, it is God himself. It's his voice, okay, explaining to you and me his love. Okay? Yeah, yeah. And I think that it goes one step further. For you and most of all of us, and when this is brand new study for me, okay, and to me, this is very, very real because of what I feel right this minute and what I'm going through, okay, and so, and I need to hear that he loves me like this, okay, and I need to know and understand. Not just his words, but his soul. You know, when you listen to those four howls, okay, and you hear that he says, my heart is turned over inside of me, okay, about you. Okay, you are my son, but you will not listen to me. Okay, and when you fail, I'll still be there, and I'll still pick you up. And that's the beautiful word that you find for Peter. It was a completely
like broken man. To this book that all put his stamp on that same thing for you. Mm-hmm. He uses your emotion and your ability to teach and your talent to teach the word, mm-hmm, by getting inside you first. And you know, you always say a word and like go next one to teach. And it seemed like he just said, here, this is a good one that you can help us understand and help you too, yeah, to put that stamp again. Yeah. You have to hear it over and over that God does love us. I mean, you think we would say, okay, he loved me. Yeah. But we don't. We just think, well, he did. He did this and this.
Yeah.
So then Satan starts unraveling that doubt again.
Right.
So thank you.
Well, and like Wilma was saying, it's you know, it's just like somebody told me, I don't know who it was, but they were using Psalm 46 in the middle of their fear. And they're going through that passage now to help them. It's not just God help me, but now it's the very words that God has said about that issue. Okay, and it's something that you stand on. But it's really not just words now, it's God himself. See, that's what you're moving. You're moving beyond the words to him. Okay, it's like hearing somebody speak, but then you really get to hug them, and see that they really love you. Okay, so it's going beyond just words. It's going deeper into who he is. Okay, and that's what we've tried to do. Let's see.
Okay. And it reminds me of some of our boys were teenagers and they went off on the wrong path. And we had tried to give them the word. We had poured out everything we had into them in the beginning. And then they went off the wrong way. And we just could not give up on them.
Mm-hmm.
And when they came back, what joy we felt, which is what the Lord feels when we come back to him.
Yeah.
And we want to pour out more on them. We want to say, it's okay. Mm-hmm. We love you. We never gave up on you. You're still our child.
Yeah.
For those of you that have had kids, sons or daughters that have gone through that.
Yeah.
You know how you felt, as imperfect as we are as parents, mm-hmm. and how much more God, who loves us and who does have a plan and who is, he gives us the word, which is light to our path and light to take the next step in that darkness, the light that overcomes the shadows that creep in. We just need to turn to the light to look at the next step when we go through these hard times, because we all had no idea, what was behind us, but that strengthens us to go on with what's ahead.
Well, next week we will be moving into chapter 12. We'll start with verse 12 and chapter 11. It's the last verse. And it's, again, it's this shift. Okay? All of a sudden, I mean, when we're talking verse 5 and 6, we have this listing of sin. Okay, and then what we have is God's response to that sin. And his anguish over it all. And how in his own mind he reaches to the very end, which seems to sustain him. Okay, that's exactly what you see in Hebrews chapter 12. Because he could see the end. He went through the pain and the suffering of the now. Okay? He could see it. He knew it. He understood it. Okay? So that's where we're to get to that point too. And that's what you find. And so what we'll list is another series of sins that he is disturbed about. And then he moves into another love passage. Okay? And this one's completely different. All of these have been different. Okay? So every one of them have been different. And they just keep adding ideas to the issue of love. Okay? So if you want to look ahead, you can do that and see. But that's where we're going next. Okay, well, we'll see you.
Oh, no.